The Football League, this week, have set up a committee to investigate the state of the game. With the 92 clubs owing banks a massive £40 million, can football survive in its present form? Will the creation of a Super League close the door on third and fourth division soccer? Good evening. The 92 clubs in the Football League are facing a bleak future. Gates have dropped to less than half their immediate post-war level, with three quarters of the clubs making a loss. This week, an inquiry under Sir Norman Chester has been set up to look at the restructuring of the league, a restructuring which may include the creation of a Super League to satisfy the demands of the rich clubs, but also plans that could lead to part-time professional football for their poorer relations. Against this background, Steve Ryder examines football's problems and future with its hint of revolution among top clubs.
Gates here and revenue represents pounds in terms over a period of time.
Bill Skinner uses soccer's problems in his business management course at Sheffield Polytechnic.
A kind of a bonus. And this
it provides a graphic illustration of a major industry in decline. And with Gates falling dramatically over the last two seasons, he can only predict an even more gloomy future.
If we compare 18th of September in 1982 with the corresponding period last year, the figures indicate that there's a shortfall of something like 70,000 spectators, which in percentage terms represents something like 14 or maybe 15% less than last year. If this trend continues, then this season's going to be critical. If there's a stronger word than critical, then next season is super critical, simply because the shortfall this year has already been offset to an extent by economies from within the game, from within clubs as a whole. Next season, some of the fat that they've got, or the fat that they've seen to pair, isn't there. And next season will be super, super critical.
Third Division Lincoln are typical of that problem. The fat was stripped from the bones long ago, even though the club is on one of the best runs in its history. Losses of £250,000 last season forced the chairman to sell the ground to the local council on a lease-back deal. But Gilbert Blades still sees gate receipts way short of the £500,000 running costs. He sold a leading player for £80,000 and cut the playing staff to just 15. He thinks the players will suffer further.
Eventually, I suppose, some of the professional players will find themselves out of a job. I think at the end of last season, when we realised we're all in trouble, a lot of players whose contracts had come to an end in fact found themselves out of jobs. And I think a lot of other professional footballers whose contracts will come to an end at the end of next season will also find themselves out of a job. So that there's a tremendous decrease in the number of professional footballers who can earn a living in the Football League.
In the meantime, the club tried to economise on the players' bonus scheme. The chairman originally demanded a 40% drop. Eventually, both sides settled on 8%, but the bonus argument had its effect on internal relations within the club.
Well, it turned a bit sour, and unfortunately, the chairman wouldn't negotiate with us anymore. And we were quite happy at that, because we remained on last year's bonus.
You say it turned a bit sour. What was the atmosphere like during those negotiations?
Well, the players wasn't speaking to any of the board or the chairman. It was just, you know, it wasn't very good for the team. But looking at it now, we're top of the league, we've done quite well.
I think it had an adverse effect on the board. It unified us and perhaps split them a bit. Mm. It's done us some good in some ways, though we could do without those problems, really.
What sort of specific things can you point at as clumsy handling of the situation from the board's point of view?
Just before we went out for a reasonably important game, it was in the programme that the gate prices were going up because the players' bonus scheme hadn't been solved. We're on the same bonus scheme as last year, so why didn't they put the gates up last year? We're supposed to go out and play in front of a crowd, and they've just read that the prices are going up because of us. Well, it's because of the board, not ours.
Anger in the dressing room, gloom at the Turnstiles, the combination so familiar to lower division clubs. A local derby with Doncaster produces no big match atmosphere, even though Lincoln are top of the third division. Manager Colin Murphy's frustration that success doesn't attract the crowds is shared by Gilbert Blades. He questions why anyone in the current financial climate would want to be a soccer club chairman.
I ask myself that every day, and I think my wife poses that question as well. But I think it's a challenge. I love the sport. I've always watched soccer. Challenging us all, isn't there, to try and solve something, if we can. I was working it out the other day. I think with the interest-free loans that you put into the club and the shares that you purchase, I think it's about, it costs us about £150 to £200 each match to watch it. I mean, that's madness, isn't it? But I think that's just about what it costs us.
The attendance is 1,000 down on last year's Doncaster game, but with cheapest adult admission rising to £2, gate receipts remain the same. The club admits that prices can go no higher. The team have given value. Doncaster are beaten 5-1, and there's a rare mood of optimism in the Lincoln dressing room. While the players dream of following Watford and Swansea on a swift rise to Division One, the chairman sees only hard times ahead for the professional footballer.
We will be seeing your local football hero on a Saturday afternoon on the park and perhaps delivering milk during the week for the local co-op.
Well, obviously, you wouldn't be a full-time professional, but as I've said, it's out of our hands. We prefer to. We think we'll play a higher standard of football. We'll get better as players, but if we're forced to play part-time, there's nothing we can do about it.
The chairman said that the day is almost here when the player that you see on a Saturday afternoon is going to be delivering the milk on a Monday morning. Do you think he's got it into perspective?
If he stayed at the club, it'd be probably true, yeah.
You said that with some feeling.
I mean it, yeah, because of the way he's handled most of the things. It's been a joke, I think.
Well, you've been fairly outspoken on the subject of the chairman and the board. What do you think is going to be his reaction when he hears your comments?
I don't think he'll be happy.
I would imagine that there'd be four players on the transfer list. No, I think he's a reasonably fair man, and I think he'll appreciate our point of view.
The smiles in the boardroom disguise the problems Lincoln face, problems that show how ill-equipped some clubs are to cope with modern financial pressures.
It's a long trip.
Directors have discovered how different football is to any other business.
The boards of directors of football clubs in the British Isles are comprised of successful businessmen, generally. And, of course, this is the silly part about it, is when they sit on a board of a football club, they do the most idiotic and stupid things financially that they would never dream of doing in their own businesses. And, I mean, I've done, I suppose, reckless things financially that I would never dream of doing in my own profession.
One effect of the reckless financial attitude can be seen in the rise and fall of the million-pound transfer market. In the previous 3 years, a total of 9 footballers have changed clubs for £1 million or more. This season, there are none, and many clubs are left high and dry with overpriced players. Chelsea are familiar with financial crisis. To help them survive, they appointed the league's first chief executive. Martin Spencer looks at soccer with an accountant's eye. Soccer is a business, requiring a business approach.
There was a particular time with a particular manager, not John Neil, where I had a total difference of opinion with the purchase of a player. Not the actual player himself, but in the amount of money that the then manager said he wanted to pay. And I had to relate what I know about the game and the relative values and say to him, you're paying twice as much as you ought to. I'm not saying he's the wrong player. And after considerable discussion with him and the fact that I eventually negotiated the purchase of that player, rightfully or wrongly, we were able to get him at very considerably less than the manager wanted. Now, the manager was prepared to pay. Now, I think that's the role that the chief executive should play. Not the choice of the buying and selling of players, but the business side. And I feel in the past, and a lot of these transfers have got out of hand, primarily because it's one very, very big ego trip that you're on the back page of the newspaper that you've bought player X for a million, and then the manager 50 miles away decides that he wants a player, but he's going to do one better, he's going to buy one for a million and a half. And it really was the director's fault, not the manager's fault, the directors, the boards of companies, who allowed managers that total freedom.
High transfer fees mean high salaries. While two players earn basics of over £60,000, 57 players in the first and second divisions earn between £30,000 and £60,000. 577 earn between £10,000 and £30,000, while at the bottom end of the scale, 641 are on £10,000 or less, and 90% of the lower division players also earn less than £10,000. The players of First Division Ipswich Town are in the upper bracket. Their cars are provided by local sponsorship arranged by the club, a club which is convinced of the value of promotion and marketing. Regular staff meetings enable Ipswich to check on all aspects of their operation, the latest investment being a new £1.4 million stand.
Next week, when we play West Bromwich, we'll have 8/9 of the seats in and usable. We've got 1/6 left to do, which will come in the middle of November. Tea bars and toilets should be open 1/2 next week, all being well.
The two rather go together, don't they?
Yeah, quite.
Sponsorship helped to build the stand, and even though the club is near the foot of Division 1, sponsorship is helping to fill it.
Now, Mel, on the sponsorship and sort of advertising, any news there?
My view, Mr. Patrick, is that we've reached the time when we should change our tactics a little. We have to adopt a more aggressive attitude towards pulling in sponsorship money, because at the moment our package really consists of various bits and pieces that can be bought as exactly that, bits and pieces.
Those bits and pieces include a tie-up with the Japanese hi-fi firm Pioneer, worth £400,000 over 3 years. And further sponsorship provides an electronic scoreboard at the Portman Road ground. On top of that, skillful dealings in the transfer market have left the club £1.5 million up. 30 executive boxes at £5,500 a season are booked solid. And a luxury restaurant open 7 days a week is enjoyed by both the fans and the players.
One of the good things that's happened this year is that there's great interest from visiting teams, the midweek matches, that we provide food for them to take on the coach, as we do for our own team. And Liverpool even took a three-course meal back. We did them a patty starter and a main course and a sweet, and they were delighted.
But I think it's up to all of us to keep on encouraging the spectators.
Absolutely.
And make life much easier for them.
The one suggestion I'm trying to work on with the players is that we visit a factory, say Fison's or Manganese Bronze or Crane's, once every month, just to walk around the factory, see the workers at their benches. They come see us Saturday playing football, and see why we shouldn't go and see them work. It may bring one or two players back down to earth to see how people make their money during the week.
The result of Ipswich's effort, a drop of only 5% in attendances in a comparatively unfashionable area for soccer. While Ipswich have maintained the enthusiasm for live soccer in Suffolk, can the appetite for league football be revived nationally? 9 months ago, advertising agency J. Walter Thompson tried to do just that with a national television campaign.
Well, I have to say that we have a problem. We have a problem in getting a collective will and support for what is essentially a league central initiative. There is obviously a lot of suspicion about marketing in general, and the requirement to promote football against other forms of competition, because as you know, clubs are essentially competitive one against the other, not in fact with other forms of entertainment.
So you're saying that before you persuade the spectators, you've got to persuade the clubs, and that's your first argument, the first battle that you've got to win?
That's the first battle you've got to win.
An obstacle in that battle is the league's requirement for a 75% majority to pass any major decision. Progress can be blocked by just a few clubs, and Secretary Graham Kelly recognises that this makes the league a very cumbersome animal.
It's become increasingly difficult, particularly with the financial difficulties, to legislate for 92 different clubs of varying abilities and sizes. It's not so much a case of vested interests, it's a case of slightly more different interests. The concern of the small fourth division club on any issue, whether it be television, sponsorship or whatever, cannot be viewed in the same way as the interests of the successful first division club, which goes on in cup competitions and European competitions. And this is the problem as far as the league, the centralised organisation, is concerned. It has become more difficult over recent years to legislate as one for the 92 different constituent parts of the league.
The 92 clubs in the Football League are divided into four divisions, and 15 years ago, Sir Norman Chester's government report into the future of football recommended the restructuring of the league into five divisions, including a first division of just 18 clubs. But Chester emphasised that this would not be the creation of a Super League. Well, now Sir Norman heads the league subcommittee tackling exactly the same problem, but the term Super League is being talked of in far more rebellious tones against a background in which the top clubs are intensely dissatisfied with the financial structure of the league. Football's rich clubs say they're subsidising the poor. For example, all clubs pay 4% of gate receipts to a central fund, from which each club gets back £30,000. The television contract is worth £2.3 million, from which each club receives £25,000. 2% of the revenue from the football pools is paid to the clubs. This pays league expenses and gives each club £22,000. And revenue from the FA Cup competition and the sponsored Milk Cup yields another £1.7 million, £17,000 per club. So regardless of success, attendances and how much they're televised, each of the 92 clubs receive £94,000. It guarantees survival to some small clubs and generates anger among the big. We invited the chairman of five leading clubs, Arsenal, Spurs, Birmingham, Brighton and Derby, to discuss the league's future over dinner.
Would you like to put those into...
Chief advocate of change is Arsenal's Peter Hill Wood.
My contention is that if you looked at it as an outsider and you looked at the Football League Limited and you as a very successful businessman, Mike, and you were given, you bought control of the Football League Limited, I mean, would you let it go on as it is with 92 outlets? 45 of them you know are never going to make a profit.
Yeah,
you wouldn't.
No,
and I think you've got to look at it that way.
Peter, I understand what you mean, but I still think that you've got to give... You can't just say goodbye to the smaller clubs.
I'm not going to say goodbye, but they're going to have to be... I think they ought to be launched off on their own.
But that's up to them, Peter.
That is the same as saying goodbye, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the same as saying goodbye.
They're still in existence, but they're not supported by the Football League.
See, I think
they may be affiliated, but they're not then subsidised by Brighton, Birmingham, Derby... Yeah.
Peter,
Arsenal,
I understand it, but why aren't we talking about what we could do tomorrow, not in a year's time or five, but why aren't we talking about government levies that I mentioned on the pools? Why aren't we talking about when the pools contract comes up, which I believe is in 1986, the Football League gets the sum, I think, I'm right in saying this, my friend Keith told me if I'm wrong, £2 million a year we get out. £2 million, that's paltry. I'm absolutely sure in my own mind that with commercialism, football could survive and every club could have enough money to survive without...
I don't disagree with that.
If nothing happens, in my personal opinion, within the next 5 years, we shan't be talking round this table. We shan't even be in existence. And you can build your stadiums, you can build your complex the same as you have done. You will not make it pay unless you entertain the public.
There's a limited amount of money in the game. And I personally believe it's spread too thinly over 92 clubs. What do you get out of television? 25,000 a year. What do Hartlepools get out of it? 25,000 a year.
Sure.
Completely pointless. Doesn't pay for a quarter of the police force that parade on your ground every Saturday.
There's so much money made outside of football. I study this. It's unbelievable. Millions and millions, you know. And we get nothing out. As Peter said, 25,000 a year. It's a joke. The whole thing's a joke.
Underlying the discussion, the thought that Sir Norman Chester's committee may recommend a Super League for the top clubs, or that the top clubs may take that course on their own. How could it be constructed?
Well, I think inevitably the Premier League or the Super League or whatever you might like to call it is going to come from the First Division clubs. I suppose if you could get Sheffield to get together and have United Wednesday, you maybe they could justify a
Arsenal
place.
Arsenal Spurs, perhaps?
Arsenal Spurs, one.
I mean, I take it if Arsenal were bulging with money and the income was far in excess of their expenditure every year, you wouldn't have even suggested this.
Yeah, is that absolutely right? Not.
Do you think in a year's time you might be going to the Football League and say, we're on our own?
I would think there's a great possibility of doing that.
Peter?
Yeah, I think it's possible. I just sincerely hope that it doesn't come to that, because I don't think that... I mean, that cannot be the right way to approach it.
I agree. It's not the thing for the good of football. And we're all in it as football. It's a sport, but we've got to run it as a business.
I'd like to think so, but I also agree with Peter. I mean, I don't want to see a breakaway, but I think it'll come. If the league don't do something about it, I think that will come. Could have come sometime.
Well, I don't think we want to think that far yet at all. I think good sense will prevail. I think good leadership, actually, if it's put forward sensibly, and we shouldn't follow it if it isn't sensible. I think that we could well be over-pessimistic at the moment.
I'm very gloomy, if you wish to know my sort of general attitude to it. And I think we had the Chester report 15 years ago, which I thought was a first-class report. And I don't say everything in it was dead right. It's bound not to be. And that was thrown in everybody's waste paper basket. And here we are again, 15 years later. And we've done sweet nothing about it. And I sort of basically despair at the thing.
The desperate mood at the top of the league is matched only by the financial desperation at the bottom. League Secretary Graham Kelly is well aware of the atmosphere in which the new committee must work.
I think it would be a very sad day indeed if the hint of revolution were ever to become a concrete fact. I hope it doesn't. I don't think it will be good for anybody in the game, the big clubs or the small clubs, certainly not for the league. I think it would be a sad day.
But it still comes down to you and your committee having to find this magic formula.
That's right. It comes down to realism, persuasion, and hopefully positive leadership. It's never been more needed than it is now.